GDScript, a Python-like high-level dynamically typed programming language made specifically for the Godot game engine. Because GDScript is built for Godot, it includes special functions and keywords that integrate directly with the engine, such as ready and process functions. To get started with GDScript, you can create a new script from the File System tab, or simply click the Attach button to create and attach a script to your node. Make sure the language is set to GDScript and hit the Create button. Here, this line, extends node2d, means that this script belongs to a node2d type. And that is because we created a script for the node2d type. If you create it for another node, you will see that node type here. And since we are extending node2d, we get to access all the properties and methods of the built-in node2d class. You can control click on it to open the documentation for that, which has all the properties that you can access and all the methods that you can use for that class. Now, there are two functions that you will see in almost all GDScript code, ready function and process function. Ready function runs only once when the node enters the scene tree, and the process function runs every frame. If we want to print something, we can use the print function. So, if I will print something in the ready function, you can see that it has been only printed once. But if I will move that print function to the process function, you will see that it is printing for infinite amount of times. And that is because our game is running and this process function will run each frame and it will execute this code each frame. Now, to declare a variable, we can use the var keyword, variable name, and then our value. There is another way too. Var keyword, variable name, colon, then data type, and then the value. The first one is dynamic typing, in which Godot automatically assigns the data type to a variable according to the value you have passed. And the second one is static typing, in which you explicitly define the data type of your variable. You can use any of these, there will be no errors, but I will recommend you to use the static typing. Let me show you something. Here, as you can see, when I assign a value of string to our score variable that is storing integer data earlier, there will be no errors. But if I will assign the same string variable to our score 1, you will see that the editor throws an error that we cannot assign a string value to an integer data type. This is very helpful. Sometimes we accidentally pass different values to our variable, but that should not change their data type, because then it will throw errors where that variable is used. Here, in the first case, now the data type of the score will be automatically changed to string because we passed a string value to it. But if we statically declare our variables, there won't be any issue like this, and the editor will point it out whenever you pass the value of the different data type. Trust me, when using static typing, you can avoid so many errors that can happen due to dynamic typing. Speaking of data types, Godot supports all the basic data types like integer, float, string, boolean, and it also has its own custom data types like vector2, which stores two values x and y, then vector3 for storing three values x, y, and z. And there's also a color type which stores color values in RGB format. These are only some of them. There are many more which you will find out as you progress. Now, to declare a function, we use the func keyword and then write our function name, and then in parentheses, we pass our function arguments and then colon, and then in next line, we start our function body. Like here, we are just printing a simple message welcome and then the player name. So in ready function, let's call the function and pass some name, for example, Chris. And now when I run it, we see that the message has been printed. There's also another way to declare a function. Like there are two ways to declare a variable, same goes for function. We can write arrow and then int. This means this function will return something, that is an int value. See, we got an error because right now our function is not returning anything. So if I will use the return keyword and return simply 1, the error will vanish. That is because now our function is returning a value of 1. But when your function is not returning anything, we can type void, which means that the function does not return anything. So, with this arrow syntax, we can explicitly define what our function returns. Now, as you can see, we are expecting a string value for pname. But if I pass an integer to the function, we won't get any error. To To avoid this, just like when declaring a variable, we can use a colon followed by the data type to specify what kind of data we are expecting. Once we do that, the editor will point it out if something's wrong, and that's really helpful. When we pass an argument, the editor now tells us that a string is expected. But if I remove the type, it says variant, which is a generic data type that can hold any value. So if I pass an integer again, there's still no error initially. But when I run the program, we get an error at line 16, and that can be pretty confusing. So always make sure to define the data type of your variables and parameters to avoid issues like this. If you go to the project settings and then to the input map tab, you can assign keys to various actions, just like I have done here. To create a new input action, type the action name, click add, then click the plus icon to assign a key. Press the key you want to use, and it will be linked to that action. For example, here I have assigned a C key for crouch. Now in GDScript, you can use the isActionPressed method from input class to check if a specific action is being triggered. Here I am checking for the action UIWrite. This is a default input action you can use for testing. If it's pressed, we move along the x-axis by changing the position of the node. You can do the same for other actions and respond however you like. For example, using UILeft and UIWrite, I move the node left and right, and for jump, I just print jump in the output console. If something is unclear, don't worry, you can always search for it. For instance, searching UIWrite will show you it's a built-in action for moving right. That said, in your own game, you should use custom input action. I have created one called MoveRight and assigned it to the right arrow key. Now I can replace UIWrite with MoveRight, and it works exactly the same. Except now it's using my own action. Conditional statements like if-else work exactly like Python. You write if followed by the condition and then the code that should run if it's true. Just like Python's match statement, GDScript also has one. You use the match keyword followed by the variable, then list the possible values and what should happen for each. It's a clean alternative to long if-else if chains. In this example, we are checking the value of lives. If it's 3, we print full health. If it's 2, we print hurt, and so on. The underscore is like the default case. If none of the values match, it prints game over. Since our lives are currently 3, it prints full health. Loops in GDScript follow the same syntax as Python. Arrays are declared using square brackets with values separated by commas. You can add new items using the append method and access elements by their index. To declare a dictionary, we use curly braces. Inside, we write key value pairs like score colon 100 separated by commas. To access a value, we use the key inside square brackets. You can also update a value by assigning a new one using the same method. And let me tell you something, documentation is your best friend when you are stuck or curious. For example, if I search for array, I get detailed info on all its constructors and methods. And if you are confused about any method, just click on it and it will tell you exactly what it does and how to use it. If you make documentation a habit, you might not even need videos like this. Now, let's talk about signals. Here, I have a button node. If I click on the node tab, I can see its signals. Signals are used to notify other nodes or scripts when something happens. For example, the press signal tells us when the button is clicked. If I double click it, a window pops us asking where to connect the signal. I am connecting it to the player node and a new function appears in the player script, on button pressed. Now every time I click the button, that function runs. In this case, it flips the sprite 2D, and yep, it works perfectly. You are not limited to built-in signals. You can create your own custom signals. Just use the signal keyword followed by a name. It will now show up in the signal list. You can emit this signal using the emit method. You can also pass data with it, but we will keep it simple for now. You can connect your own custom signal to any other script. Just to demonstrate, I have connected it to the button script. Instead of creating a new function, you can even connect it to an existing function. Here, we are hiding the button using the hide method. Since this script is attached to the button, self refers to the button itself. So now, when I click the button, it flips the logo and hides the button. Both actions happen one after the other. One last tip. If you want to edit variables directly from the editor without reopening the script, use the export annotation. This makes the variable appear in the inspector where you can tweak its value easily. Super useful, right?